Okay, now we're going to do part C. So we have to decide if f is 1 to 1 or not. If f is 1 to 1, then we don't have to do anything and we're done. If f is not 1 to 1, we got to provide a counterexample. Now, with this problem, you would need a much bigger table, I think, to decide if it's 1 to 1 or not. That's why this is the problem that's on the lecture and not on the worksheet. Okay, so what would happen in real life? In real life, a mathematician or something, would have a much bigger table. They'd compute a bunch of values, maybe probably use a computer to compute a bunch of values, maybe write a little for loop and check. Well, I guess it'd be hard to check for one-to-oneness, probably. Well, I guess you could make a little array and then blah, blah, blah. Okay, I'm not going to go into that. I could think how to do that, maybe. But anyway, you would need a bigger table and to check a lot more values to decide whether or not you think it's one-to-one or not. Now, I'll tell you, this function is one-to-one. But just having a table, now here's the main point, though. The main point is that just having a table with a bunch of values, a finite number of values, that doesn't really tell you if it's one to one or not. Even if every single value, even if it appears to be one to one on a table of with 10,000 entries, that still isn't enough. So the only way to know for sure is to prove it. And I'll prove that here. I'll prove it here. I think you'll like the proof. It's kind of neat. All right. So, but the main point that even if you're not a mathematician, you don't want to be a mathematician, whatever. 1,000 data points is not a proof. You can get empirical evidence, but that's different than proof. Proof is a little different thing than empirical evidence. All right. So having a table like we have here is suggestive. It suggests that something is true or false. To know for sure, we'd have to prove it. So I'll do a proof now that this function is in fact one to one. All right, so let me write the statement here. So I'll write f from z plus cross z plus into the natural numbers, the rule f of mn Okay, so now I'm going to prove it's one to one. All right, so the thing to remember, to prove that it's one to one, we want to satisfy the definition. The definition is an if-then statement. That if-then statement is x1 not equal to x2 implies f of x1 not equal to f of x2. But the proof actually is easier using the contrapositive. Okay, so the contrapositive, right, remember the contrapositive of p implies q, right, this is equivalent to not q implies not p. So I'm going to prove that if f of x1 is equal to f of x2, then x1 equals x2. So that's the contrapositive. Now, you may notice a little something weird going on here, right? Because the elements in here look like are ordered pairs. m n. And here I have x1 and x2. Okay, so I need to rewrite it for a domain. So I'm going to sit with the domain being z plus cross z plus, positive integers. So what I'm going to prove is that f of m, if f of m n equals f of a b, then m n equals a b. And really for all majors, I mean, computer science, and for all the computer science majors out there, yeah, you probably won't have to prove something like this, but the discussion I just had about the logic, the contrapositive, all that sort of stuff, that's proof logic. And that's one of the big things that the computer science department wants you to know. Okay, so I'll do the proof now. Proof. Okay, so let's see. Okay, so my assumption, I'm just assume that mn, the point mn is a ordered pair in z cross z, so that means m and n are z plus cross z plus, excuse me. So m and n are positive integers, a and b are positive integers. So remember, to prove an if-then, right, we assume this, we show that. So we assume all right, so we have a rule, right? Our rule tells us what f of mn is and what f of a b. Is okay. Okay. So they're equal there. And remember, what I'm trying to show is that, is this right here, right? That mn equals ab. Now remember, when are ordered pairs equal? When their x coordinates are equal and their y coordinates are equal. So what I'm really trying to show is that m equals a and n equals b. Right, so in the back of our minds, let's keep track of that. Maybe I'll put it up here. Want to show, want to prove, m equals a, n equals b. All right, so I'm gonna have to pull out all the stops for this one. So kind of maybe a Morpheus moment here. Did you know we can assume M is less than A? All right. So how can we assume that? All right. So this is kind of so I'm going to say without loss of generality. So, now what does this mean? Without loss of generality. So maybe I'll just say we can assume. And I'll explain why we can do this. We can assume M is less than or equal to a. Okay, so why can we assume that? Oops. M is less than or equal to a. Okay, so we can assume M is less than or equal to a, because if that's not the case, right, if it wasn't the case that M was less than or equal to a, then we could rename the M, the things that we could rename things and then have M less than or equal to a. Right, so if it was the case that M was bigger than a, then I would just say, well, let's call whatever a is M and whatever M is a, and then we'll have M is less than or equal to a. Right, so this is what we say, what we call without loss of generality. It doesn't change the generalness of the proof at all to assume that M is less than or equal to a. Because if M is bigger than a, well then guess what? We'll say a is equal to M, and now M is equal to a, and then everything will be fine. If you don't quite understand that yet, that's okay. You've heard the word without loss of generality. It took me a few times before I heard that word, before I understood it, or that phrase. No big deal. Okay. So because M is less than or equal to A, okay, so now we're going to divide both sides. By 2 to the m minus 1. Okay, so if m is less than or equal to a, that means that m minus 1 is less than or equal to a minus 1, right? Remember, adding and subtracting doesn't flip the sign. It's only when you multiply or divide by a negative. So adding a negative, otherwise known as subtraction, doesn't change to flip the sign. Okay. So we divide both sides by 2 to the m minus 1 to get 2n minus 1 equals 2 to the a minus 1. That's a 2, not a z. Sorry. My 2s definitely look like z's. Okay, it's 2 to the a minus 1 over 2 to the m minus 1 times 2b minus 1. All right, now, okay, so now here's where this key piece of information comes in. Right, since m minus 1 is less than a minus 1, we can divide, if you think of it like 2 to the 10th over 2 to the 5th is 2 to the 10 minus 5. So if you have a bigger number on top that has the same base, you can divide into it, right? 2 cubed over 2 is 2 to the 4th. Okay. So let's see. Okay. Doing fine. Don't worry. I will have enough room. I know you're on the edge of your seat. Okay. So now 2n minus 1 equals. Okay. Now, right. So here, let me show you this okay, real fast. Let's do 2 cubed over 2 squared, right? That's 8 over 4, which is 2, right? But another way to think of this, remember, this is 2 to the 3 minus 2. And you can do that little work. So this is 2 to the a minus 1 minus m minus 1 times 2b minus 1. Okay, now here's where I can use my eraser to help me out a little bit. All right, so now distributing this negative right here through, right, what do we get? We get negative m plus 1. Okay, so we have a minus 1 minus m plus 1. All right, so now we can So let's see, now we can say cancel those ones. And now this becomes, oops, okay, A minus M times 2B minus 1. Like that. Okay, now look at our equation, right? We have a funny equation here, right? 2n minus 1, this is an odd number, right? And this is an odd number. And this is even, right? So given our assumption, right, our assumption that f of mn equals f of ab, right? Why can we assume that, right? Well, if it's false, then the statement is true anyway, right? So we may as well assume it. Well, okay, so if we assume it, then we get down to this funny equation where we have an odd equal to an even times an odd. Now, an even times an odd is an even, right? Remember that? Even times odd is even, right? So the only way that this could be true, right, is if the only way that this could be true is if we have a zero in this exponent, right? If that's a zero there, then we have 2 to the 0, which is 1, and we have odd equals odd. So the only way this could be true, right, is when a minus m equals 0. So a equals m. Remember, that's the first thing we wanted to prove here. Check. Okay, so if a equals m, what happens? So if a equals m, then we have 2 to the 0 here, right? We have 2 to the 0 here. 2 to the 0 is 1. So then we have 2n minus 1 equals 2b minus 1. Now doing the math here, we cancel those out, divide by 2. Right? And that's the proof.